Welcome everyone. نحن أنا وكريس ونادين من مؤسسي بيروت AI. نحن City AI. It's a global community. It spans across 40 cities across the globe. نحن we're the first mover in Lebanon and in the Middle East as well. نحن هلا جايبين بيروت AI لحتى نجمع العالم مع بعضه منشان to enable people to apply artificial intelligence. To apply artificial intelligence to solve a specific business challenge, for example, or to solve a different challenge, non-business related. So نحن هلا هدفنا إنه to connect everyone, all peers, practitioners, leaders in the industry, with people so that they can get to know each other and maybe help each other in solving challenges related to AI. Okay, so أنا زياد فواز, أنا marketing communications expert, and Chris is a software engineer. And Nadine is a software engineer as well. Okay. Hello. The agenda for today is: first thing, can feel registration. اللي ما عمل registration, بس please بالآخر يعمل حط اسمه please. Beirut AI. حعرفكم عن Beirut AI. Hello. Afterwards, there's gonna be a speaker, Dr. Elie Kawerk, and then Alexy Frangieh. Two speakers, then there's going to be a Q&A session, then there's an AI clinic session through which we're going to tackle challenges related to AI with the help of each other, and afterwards it's a networking session for everyone, and inshallah by 5:30 we'll be all finished, okay? Okay, so this is the Applied Artificial Intelligence community. We host local quarterly gatherings. The events usually attend later for artificial intelligence practitioners focusing on lessons learned applying AI. Each gathering consists of three elements, enabling interactive sessions through which you will discover 15-minute talks of industry peers sharing insights. You will connect peer-to-peer sessions on machine learning, natural language processing, and computer vision to connect with the leading practitioners in the technology realm. Tereci, you're gonna share. The clinic sessions, اللي حنعملها هلا بعد شوي, هي for practitioners to share their specific challenge applying AI. Okay, so come in, we're gonna do some ecosystem mapping, basically, understanding what are the challenges, who's doing what and why. بالنسبة للeducation, basically it's by connecting people together, so there's an opportunity for you to learn as well. So the potential of AI in 40 plus cities, and of Africa, the Asia, Australasia, Europe, North America, or South America. هون أكيد ما حدا شايف بس نحن النقطة الوحيدة في الشرق الأوسط بالأحمر أزرق نحن لبنان أول شيء جينا لهلا so this is the team زياد marketing communications Christophe computer vision and machine learning engineer Nadine Sarraf machine learning engineer so we would like to thank Antwork of course and Dutch for hosting us today, and Montasser Othman for helping us film this event, and for photography. Okay, so now I'm gonna pass on to Chris.
Thank you. So, like Ziad mentioned, our community is all about sharing knowledge, which is why during our local gathering, quarterly gathering, we bring AI experts to share their experiences with us. And today we have two great speakers who come from different backgrounds and who will share their experiences with us. So we'll first start with Elie. Elie is a data scientist and he will talk to us about his journey in data science and how you can start your journey in data science as well. Please welcome Elie Kawerk.
So thank you for this introduction. Christophe, so this will be entitled How to Start Your Journey in Data Science. My name is Elie. I'm a self-taught data scientist, so here I'll be presenting what worked for me, at least, to start my journey in data science and how you can learn from what I learned. So the outline would be as follows. First, we will introduce data science and what benefits does it bring. We'll see where you should start. We'll talk about the process itself. We'll talk about the techniques you must know to tackle some problems. Also, we will tackle the essential technologies you should master, and then how you should proceed, and how you shouldn't proceed also. As a final example, I will present a personal project I've done for a startup as an example at the end, and then I'm going to present some useful resources. So data science is all about solving problems. It's not about data, it's about using data to solve problems. Usually one has a problem, one gathers data about this problem, builds a model, and at the end there are insights that should be extracted. So it's easy for one to get distracted by the technical stuff, but it's not about technical issues, it's about solving problems. So for business problems, these could be reducing costs, increasing ROI. For economic problems, it could be something else. So it's all about solving problems. So let's see some example. Let's say a software company wants to reduce online subscription for software as service. It's going to use data to do so. Or Netflix, when it does movie recommendations. Also, predicting the stock market is related to data. So you take historical data, you fit a model, and you try to predict the future. Or to build a portfolio, for example. Building chatbots also is an example. Self-driving cars, software are an example. I can go on forever. There are lots of examples. You can see them everywhere in your daily life now. So in a nutshell, data science is about extracting actionable insights, whether these insights are business, societal, or economic, or whatever, by exploring and modeling data to solve a specific problem. So, what benefits does data science bring? So, first there is automation, because when you have huge amount of data, it's not easy for a person to do it by himself. So, it's making decisions on empirical evidence to spot and exploit patterns in data that are hard to be observed by experts, human experts. And second, it reduces the bias that may be introduced by human experts. Rework data is messy. You're gonna be spending a lot of time cleaning it. And it's really, really messy. So it's not like a toy data set that you take on a MOOC, for example, and you try to model things. No, it's about really making data clean. Problems are ambiguous, so they're not well defined. You have to find a way to frame a problem and learn how to think probabilistically about things. You'll always also be learning new technologies and new techniques, so embrace this fact also. So what you know now may be obsolete in 2 years from now. So let's see how the process goes. You start first with a problem. For example, a company wants to reduce wants to increase employee retention. Okay? This is a problem. How can we do it? So first, it picks a business metrics, for example, as in the baseline. For example, the company needs to retain at least 80% of its current employees. Then you can, for example, gather data that you suspect relevant for the problem. For example, how many years has there been this employee working in the company? Does he have children? What are his hobbies? Everything that you suspect that may be helpful to model employee retention. You ask experts also to understand the problem more. So it's always important to have the opinion of experts to see what is beneficial as data and what is not. So the process is as follows. So as we said, you frame the problem, you go gather data, you can design an experiment by surveys or other files, or from the web you can scrape data, you can pull data from a database. All of this is gonna constitute what you call raw data. So this is unclean data. It looks like nothing. You have individual records. So you want, in the beginning you want to do data cleaning. For example, if you have a feature that is the price cannot be negative. Sometimes you may find that you have a price that is negative, so you have to deal with these corrupt cells, for example. You have to munge it, wrangle it. So for example, if you have a supermarket, it's going to have single invoices or single items bought. You want to group buy customer, for example, see the average customer purchase or the maximum purchase that he does. So at the end, you want to obtain clean data. So data that is tidy. This data can be, in my opinion, in the beginning, you have to apply some exploratory data analysis or do some small statistical summaries and visualize the dependencies between the features and the labels that you want to predict. Also, you can apply machine learning to get models. So, but as you can see, this is a cyclic problem. So sometimes you may not get the accuracy you want. So you want to design another experiment, get more data, pull data from another source. So it's you want to reiterate many times here. At the end, you get insights. And this is the most crucial part. If you can't communicate well, your technical background is not going to be beneficial a lot, because people in business want to understand what's happening. So you have to do storytelling through data, through visualization, through everything. I mean, everything you went through here does not have any value if you can't communicate it well. So this is crucial. Let's see. So here are some techniques to know. Experimental design. So you want to design experiments that reduce sampling bias. So you want, if you're studying, for example, the population, you want to take into account everything, every possible scenario that can be in this population. Also, you want to know web scraping, APIs, and databases to be able to pull data. You want to be able to clean data, wrangle it, and manipulate it so it's ready to be processed. Exploratory data analysis, as we said, statistical analysis and machine learning, and data visualization and storytelling. So let's see the essential techniques to know. How many of you are familiar with Python or R? Let's say, what do you use mostly, Python or R? Python?
Python.
R? Okay. I'd say something, both are good. So I said, those of you who know Python, don't know R, learn R. So, and also vice versa, because both are good. Now, if you don't know programming, I think it's good to learn any of these two in the beginning, master it, deep dive into it, and really, at the end, also learn the other language. Why? Most companies will ask you, okay, you may have a single language that they use, but you may also have another company that uses the other language, so don't limit yourself to one choice. Both are good, both have great ecosystems. Now, R is more of a statistical programming language. Python is general purpose, so it's up to you, but learn both, I think. But learn one, dive into it, and then learn the other. SQL is very important also. You're gonna be using SQL a lot to pull data from a database, for example. Version control through Git is very important, and there's an online platform called GitHub, also used for collaboration, where you can share your code and see also the history of your code. In the end, when you master these technologies, it's important also to learn a big data framework. For example, Spark is very good. It can process data on clusters, and it has also many good libraries, and it's evolving. So for the Python stack in data, you have Pandas, NumPy, Matplotlib, Seaborn, Bokeh, TensorFlow, and Keras. R is also good. It has Deployer, TidyR, Tidyverse, ggplot. Forecast, for example, is great for time series forecasting. The capacities of R in time series analysis, for example, are much greater than those of Python so far. But it's going to catch up. Big data frameworks are important, like Spark with Scala. Scala is also a great language that you can use because it supports the functional paradigm, which is also beneficial to treat big data. But also Spark has an API in Python, R, and Java. There's also Kafka and Elasticsearch for streaming data in real time. And finally, when you master these, machine learning as a service is good also. You can use Docker, which is to containerize your applications, or Flask and Django to serve your applications on a web app or a mobile app. So to build a strong foundation, what should you do? First, if you don't know how to program, any of you doesn't know how to program? So even if you don't know how to program, you start by learning a programming language like Python or R. Try this website, it's very good. It's for data science, but they have small tutorials and programming for beginners in Python. And complete programming projects. Don't learn syntax. You'll forget syntax. It's not useful. Programming is not, we don't aim to program. We aim to solve problems through programming. So complete challenges, small projects, build a small calculator, for example, a small app. Also, you should master basic statistics, probability, and linear algebra and calculus. These are important. If you don't know these, there's the MIT Open Courseware. They have a lot of great courses. There are lots of free courses online. Just take them, build a strong foundation. Probability is very important also. So how should you proceed now? Practice manipulating data sets and munging real-world data. Now, real-world data is everywhere. You can grab data from Kaggle or grab it yourself from an API or from whatever source. Ask some NGO to provide data to you. Understand statistics and machine learning fundamentals, because when you want to model the data, you don't want to get like wrong models. Now, the aim of modeling is to generalize. So you have some data, you want to generalize on unseen data. You have to understand the fundamentals of statistics and machine learning. Otherwise, you'll be producing models that are not functional. Most importantly, set a plan with landmarks and complete small projects. Now, how should you proceed? We're still at you, what you should proceed. Now, you should learn how to communicate effectively through blogging or story, or for example, doing small presentations in meetups or mentoring, for example. So if a friend of yours doesn't understand the concept in machine learning, you can explain it in simple terms, simplify it. Also, show how your analysis provides business insights or societal or economics or any kind of value. Otherwise, because at the end of the day, what you want to bring is insights from data. It's not about the technical stuff. The technical stuff are tools that you use in order to get value at the end. And you should love data, like grab data, wrangle it. The more you practice, the more you get to know the data, the more you will build nicer models and performing models. So how shouldn't you proceed? Stop taking courses randomly, erratically, out of context, and emphasizing too much on theory. It's not a theoretical, it's not academia here, it's not courses, okay? Theory, you should know theory just enough to apply the models, but don't go deep dive, like, for example, read some encyclopedic textbooks. No, that's not good. Learn programming, don't learn programming syntax instead of solving problems through programming. So programming is not a name in of itself, so you should learn. You shouldn't learn syntax only. Use programming to solve problems. And only emphasizing on technical aspects and neglecting communication, this is not gonna get you a job. So no matter how good you are technically, you're not gonna be able to get a job if you neglect communication and you highlight the value that you are bringing. So let's, I'm gonna present a personal project. This is just a highlight. This is one possible project, but there are lots of opportunities where you can use data. So I've predicted the time-dependent concentration of CO2 as a function of meteorological conditions for London, for a European city, for a startup. So the data, the time series data was provided already by stakeholders, so historical data about the concentration of CO2. I've augmented it, enriched it with weather data I pulled from an API. So I wrangled everything, I cleaned it to make it tidy and to make it as a table. Then I modeled the data using machine learning that takes into account not only historical data, but also wet meteorological condition. At the end, this model I built outperformed the previous time series model by 3% root mean square error, which is very good. Also, I communicated the insights I got, so how this concentration, for example, varied with wind speed or wind direction, etc. And finally, I delivered a model that was deployed into a mobile app. Now we can talk about other projects I've done in the clinic session. Now, some useful resources that you could use. In my opinion, so I'm a bit biased because I teach for a platform called DataCamp. I'm preparing a course for them. It's a very good platform. They have tracks also. You can start from scratch even if you don't know programming. Basically, any of you doesn't know DataCamp? Any of you does know it? You know it, okay. So DataCamp is a platform where you code online, so in the browser. They have small videos, and then each video like explains a concept, and then you code it. You practice coding through exercises after each video. There's also DataQuest is very good. It's similar to DataCamp, but they don't have any videos. They did dive a bit more into machine learning, for example, theory. just enough theory, not a lot of theory. And there's also Elite Data Science is good. They have a good blog also. For machine learning, there's this blog also I like a lot. It's called machinelearningmastery.com by Jason Brownlee. Also, I'm biased because I was a reviewer for this book. It's called Python Machine Learning by Sebastian Rushka, Pack Publishing. This is a very good book. It lays a strong foundation for model building evaluation for TensorFlow, also in the second edition. There's also this very good book I discovered recently. It's called Hands-on Machine Learning with Scikit-Learn and TensorFlow. It's by Aurélien Geron, O'Reilly Publishing. So this is a very good one also. Finally, you can find also a lot of good courses on Udemy. For job hunting, try this site. I found it useful. It's called markballoon.com. And here's some resources for the R guys. So R for Data Science by Hadley Wickham. He's the superstar of R. And finally, thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Elie. Does anyone have any questions for Elie?
Hi, how are you?
So where are you now? Are you doing business with data science?
I'm freelancing, actually. Not yet completely immersed, but I'm on my way negotiating some of the big companies.
Have you been able to experiment with data that is relevant to the country rather than...
Now I'm trying. I've contacted, actually, an NGO for to analyze data about corruption in Lebanon. So let's see. I'm still waiting for this. For Lebanon, I mean, I'm waiting for this NGO. Let's see how it goes.
Yes.
Any questions?
When you're solving a machine learning problem, how do you know which model to choose? I mean, this insight to know which model to choose, which approach, is it by trial and error or by getting insight of the data or machine learning theory?
Oh, so first of all, tidy the data, make it clean, remove outliers if they're not relevant. When you have clean data that is not biased, then we can talk, okay? So once you have this clean data, first of all, you can't know which machine learning model would perform best. There's a theorem in machine learning called no free lunch. It tells you that you can't know ahead of time. So you should try everything. Everything that you suspect that's going to be useful, okay? Try by tuning a little bit the hyperparameter. See which one gets you the best performance that you wish on the metric that you picked, okay? This metric could be, I don't know if you're familiar, F1 score,
yes.
Whatever, okay? The ones you see most promising, take them, 2-3 models, tune the hyperparameters. You can finally, if it achieved, for example, the metric that you've picked, the baseline that you've picked, okay, that's it, if it's enough. If not, for example, you can also apply, I don't know if you're familiar with model stacking.
We're familiar with ensemble.
Ensemble, which is, stacking is an ensemble method. Stacking, in stacking, you take, for example, few learners, and then you take a meta learner, and you train it on the outputs of the base learners, and then you get a meta model that predicts also. So it takes, for example, if these are the predictions are not correlated, the predictions of these base model are not correlated, you're gonna get a meta learner that performs better in principle.
If I may add as well, it also depends on your data. So if it's kind of wide rather than tall, if it's a time series and the time steps are very close to each other, so you need a model that remembers very well. So there are some established sort of correlations between what your data looks like and presumably what model should be adapted.
So you mean if you have a memory?
As Elie has said, no, it's what your data looks like. Is it, are there too many missing values? Are there too many categorical values, etc.? And then you can build on it the way that Elie.
Yeah, I assumed that you were talking about cross-sectional data, not time series data.
No.
Not time series, yeah, okay. If it's time series, that's a different treatment, as Dr. Fatima said, so. Yes?
You just mentioned that we should not be diving deeply into theory, so can I add to it unless you are doing research?
You're doing here data science, it's not academic research.
If it is academic, so we should... Right.
Yes, that's your job.
Yeah.
It's a different job. It's different. So if basically in academia, what you do is theory. You don't care a lot. So you should find a balance. For example, to for example, if if you found out later that maybe you're not that interested in theory, this way you have the skills to apply them to business problems. So try to balance both.
I work on MATLAB and I have to...
Don't. Go learn Python. Don't. Nobody uses MATLAB except in academia. Yeah. Even in academia, much less and less.
And I'm going to use Python since I need to work on that and Raspberry Pi. For that, I need some comparison to MATLAB.
But Raspberry Pi is compatible. You can use Raspberry Pi with Python.
I work on MATLAB and I'm learning Python to work on Raspberry Pi.
Okay, what's the
question? I need some comparison between MATLAB and Raspberry Pi.
Between MATLAB and Python?
And Python, yes.
Comparison?
Small.
What do you mean? Please explicitly say, what do you mean by comparison? Is the syntax similar?
No,
it's very similar.
Not syntax. I need the
mapping.
This is more details of calling functions and that is. How it's useful for working with it. Not useful, easy and simple.
You mean how easy is it to work with Python for Raspberry Pi and machine learning?
Yes.
It's the easiest thing that you can do. I can't think of any language that's simpler than Python. It's really like pseudocode, and it's powerful. And if you learn, for example, multiprocessing and advanced stuff later, you can get like performance that is comparable to C or C++. So, and the most important thing, it's not because, I mean, there are languages that are better than Python, maybe for some tests, but Python is great because it has a great community. So there are lots of packages, so you can do almost everything with it. And also, I like R a lot, so both R and Python are good. It depends on what you want to do. For time series, for example, I find R better. For other tasks, computer vision, for example, no. Or deep learning, no. So it depends on the task you want to do. But as I said, try to learn both. Both are good. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Our next speaker comes from a different background. Alexey is a visual artist. He's an expert in time lapse and sequential photography. And he's here today to talk to us about his perspective on AI and to share with us some insights. Please welcome Alexy Frangieh.
Hello, everyone. I want to ask first how many of you guys believe that logic is something general? And how many of you believe that logic is only domain specific? Okay, so I need a little bit like the irrational part of you and not the if and then mode. Okay, my approach, first let me say a bit more about myself. I've been into computers since like I was 8. It was the 8086, if any of you guys know it. And later on, when graphics advanced a bit, so we could see colors on screens and so I developed an interest in graphics, and later on in photography, and especially in time-lapse photography. I am on the test program of Nikon for new camera models, and currently I'm shooting for BBC documentary. So, and I have a background in linguistics and cybernetics in the conceptual form and not the practical form. Okay, AI is now the second wave of AI in which we are now. It is a very unique chance for humanity to reverse engineer evolution and help us achieve the IA, which is the intelligence augmentation, what should be the aim, and AI should be only a tool. And as the doctor says before, it is not about the coding skill, because AI is also a chance like to reverse engineer the mechanics of the one human brain that has many forms in many disciplines, arts, science, and so. And everyone who is doing AI has to decide whether to be a very skilled carpenter or to be a sculptor. Being a carpenter is doing carpentry technically very good. Being a sculptor is dealing more with concepts and other non-tangible things. Okay, so for me, AI is humanity's chance for augmentation. How this augmentation occurs? First, AI should not have its aim to mimic the human brain, because the human brain is complex enough, and we need a higher intelligence to analyze our brain. So, like, the brain can't do the feedback on itself to reverse engineer. And the second thing, if we see historically, this is a chance of augmentation. Like if we see the human evolution throughout history, he always made tools, so he induced himself in a positive feedback, like he gets the skill, now he practices more, now his brain has this new skill, and it's a exponential build-up, okay? So the augmentation happened, for example, when the human used the donkey. First, it expanded his range, and second, it expanded his ability to carry. So now we're not dealing with a human only, we're dealing with a system, like you say, a human asinine system, and a human donkey system, which is a combination, which is much more powerful than a donkey by itself and a human being by itself. Okay, so in here, the augmentation is how we upgrade the whole system. Or for example, when you take your phone and call someone in Los Angeles, now your voice usually it goes like few hundred meters. Now you're expanding your vital range to, let's say, it's 12,000 kilometers. You see, this system, the human and the phone is a self-contained system that has the augmented capability, which is usually limited by our physics or hearing or sight. And in all senses, the same applies. If we see all the tools we have made are augmenters, actually, and AI should be no different. If AI won't have its target to augment the human perception, it will be just another traditional high-tech feature, okay? So my experience with AI is, actually, I have friends that do research in AI in Luxembourg, and we have a lot of talks. So usually I design concepts to what, and they do the carpentering, you know? So, and I work a lot with millions of sequences of photos in my work. So I thought that AI could be used in a very smart way, and a bit away from the conventional image recognition, which is so irrelevant, because it is brute forcing is like a way of, like, bulls work, not like human beings. So in one of our talks, okay, in one of our talks, I told them, why don't we first teach the machine the semantics, the words? Let's have somehow a verbose communication with the machine. So we needed to teach the machine some concepts. Let me talk about this project. In this project, there was 183,000 photos, okay? It is the same frame over 1 year, okay? We didn't need to go into the actual pixels of any photo. This is so inefficient, at least for such kind of project. So we only used the metadata of the pictures we took, okay? With only using two parameters, okay? Which is the timestamp and the recording of light that the camera takes to know how much light there is. Okay, It took 3 minutes with AI to reverse engineer the Pavlovian. It's like, really, you know, Pavlov, the guy, there's a bell and his dog. Too bad that in 2000, almost 20, and we still have such simple defense and chips, okay? We were able to define these terminologies, day, night, noon, twilight. Twilight is actually one entity if you use one level. Moonrise, moonless, gibbous moon, full moon, clear, cloud, hazy, winter, summer, spring, fall. Spring, fall are one entity. And the solstice is like the longest day, and equinox is when the day are even. We didn't refer to A absolutely. This is only a database, and I didn't give them access on the actual pictures. And we didn't aggregate any field, okay? But how, why we did this? Okay, this is a little video, just a sample to show you how the sample goes and the sequence goes. This is only around 3,000 photos, and the projects are usually 100,000. So, but there is, you see, there is a lot of things to notice. Oops, sorry. Yeah. No. Okay, no problem. Okay, we'll skip this, we'll come to this. The first thing I cared, due to my interest in both cybernetics and linguistics, is to define what is a word like we speak. Okay, a word, it's actually a cloud, it is not a monolith. Okay, the word has its very center where it is more most descriptive, and it goes like fading away until it becomes irrelevant or ambiguous or descriptive enough, okay? Later on, when we interfere two words, okay, we start to witness the creation of new words, like the day where the day and the night do the interference, this is twilight, okay? And if we go to another level, you see how we began to create some kind of language from two simple words? Okay. Okay, this is a sample field for the database we used for analysis. This, what you see in here, it's a typical light variation of one day. This is actually 24 hours, and we have like 345 charts of this. This is night, this is the dawn, this is the daylight, and this is the sunset, and back to the night. And we have this thing repeating and doing variations for 365 days, okay? These are the two main fields, the time of capture and the recorded light value. In this one, you see how much potential we have if you want to use the conventional image recognition. Usually systems are being trained on very various samples, but if we have a sequence and the variation is very small between the frame and the other, it is much easier to teach and categorize. For example, the cloud types, we can now document the type of flow which we don't have in current image recognition. Okay. And the project you see in here, in this one, it goes two parts. The first part is very straightforward, the querying from database. So we did some kind of cascading queries and to make the first part of the video. The second part of the video, we just said to the machine something like this: we need the best daylight lighting over 9 months. This is somehow programmatically what we told the machine, and this is what we got. Okay, so to round up, like doing this job humanly, selecting these photos is humanly impossible, believe me. And one important lesson from AI, it is yet another very advanced tool, so we can bother in thinking and not care for the labor. And hopefully it will help us like notice the things we usually detect but do not realize. And thank you all. Any questions?
Why was the video, the time lapse, distorted? The images was.
No, this is an editing part. Like. Human artistic intervention, but the AI was in selecting the sequences that were put together.
So I probably got a bit lost. You were trying to choose the image with the sort of sunniest skies or something along.
No, we told the system, yep, that we need the most coherent daytime sequence of photos. Like you see,
what do you mean by coherent?
Coherent, I mean, like, for example, if it picks like a picture well lit in the morning and it picks another one from another day, the next day in the evening, you will have like a flash of shadows, yeah. And it won't be like, it will be disruptive, it won't be smooth this way. In here, actually, in this one, I designed an algorithm which is, I like to call the funiamburi, means the guy who walks on a rope. It is like, if you can imagine it, it's like a rope where you have two parameters. One is the rope thickness and the second the rope fluidity. And you run this rope across the time series and determine what's the best path.
So I'm just trying to see if what kind of extensions to the industry this can have. Do you think this can be extended, for example, to sift through photos for security reasons, say to detect an anomaly and certain behavior in a region where...
Yes, actually it's one of the main applications, and believe me, handling large volumes of photo
is extendable to anomaly detection
Yes, the important thing in such a system when developed is to be verbose, like you talk to, with words, not with like predefined values and so. So the first layer is like to define the semantics, mm-hmm. with all their discrepancies, and later on usually what's important in doing such sequences is, as I told you, you can deduce flows. Flows are not into consideration in any kind of modern AI. They are very monolithic. They go, is this a milk can, yes or no, somehow. Meanwhile, in here you have the flow, and the flow by itself is it's the best way to deduce patterns.
So maybe observe changes in human body based on some, you know, exposure.
Any type of flow.
Has this been implemented somewhere?
Actually, in my current company, we're doing like some aggregation between imagery and sensing to detect bottlenecks on big projects visually. Any other questions?
You have two attributes in your metadata set. Your average in those and getting.
It is not about averaging.
The two attributes are always distinct.
Yes, surely we didn't do any aggregation.
Shouldn't have picked the actual video as it is.
No, it is 183,000 frames. Over 1 year.
And yeah, but I mean
the result video, how many frames? Mm-hmm.
No, I mean because the goal was to pick sequential.
Yes.
Sequential flow. That's the source material, the sequential flow. So you insert the random offset at times. That's why.
The capture is very straightforward. It is like. Take a photo every conventional time lapse. The second part of it, which we needed to use AI for, is like to make the 9 months video compressed. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Alexey.
So now we get to the second part of our event. Nadine will tell us more about the clinic session.
As we mentioned before, our main mission is to share our knowledge and to help our member to share and to solve any problem that are facing. So in this clinic session, please, if anyone is using AI, who is learning and AI, has any question or is facing any challenges, please let us know so me, Christopher, our speakers, or anyone in the audience who can help you.
In our project, we aim to help students, school students, to learn a lesson by using AI.
So we want to use AI to know which type of content we have to give for our student, for each student, the best content to him to learn. By content, I mean we can give him a text, an audio, a video with many levels. So how can we use AI to decide for each student the best content to help him learn any lessons?
Let me ask you, do you have data already?
What do you mean by data?
Have you gathered any data about students? Like, for example, expose students to a particular questions and see if they scored well or not.
For now, we are doing this stuff.
Yes. You have to frame the problem first, as I said. So here you'll be using most probably machine learning. It's a pattern recognition.
Okay.
So I don't like the term AI a lot because it's an umbrella term. It includes many, many things. So let's be specific. This is machine learning. It's basic pattern recognition. So what you want at the end is that you want to know what kind of output would you be serving the student, no? So is it text, what level? So I think it's a multi-output problem in the sense that you want to know if you output a text and what level should it be, okay? So maybe you should gather data. I mean, let's think about this. I don't have any experience with it, but it would be great if you start gathering data about the students, like expose a specific student to a text of level 1, see what his performance will be.
This course.
So maybe you take all of these as features and you try to build a model that sees the score at the end of the student. I mean, how well did he perform? So
what we are doing now, we are asking student many questions to know maybe the best type of content they prefer, audio or video or picture. After they decide, we start giving them a real content of the preferred type they prefer.
I understand, but the thing here is what you want to do at the end is that you want to maximize the performance of the students. That's the metric, no? How do you quantify it? With like a score, no?
Okay.
So maybe you should see, maybe grab metadata about the students. His hobbies, maybe if he's an artist, for example, if he likes art, maybe he's more into visual stuff, you see? So maybe you should grab some data about, does he draw, does he play music, does he write, for example, anything else that you have in mind that could be relevant.
Okay,
grab this data, expose him to a text, for example, with a certain level, with a certain difficulty. All of these are features. And see at the end what's the score. Build a model that takes the from these features that can predict the score. Okay? At the end you'll have like the importance of the feature. You can use many models that have the capacity of extracting the information at the end. How much relevant is the feature for example, predict the grade of the students. So maybe you can use the most important features and from these predict really what's more suitable for this particular student. Does this make sense?
Yes.
I want to add something though, that in the learning process that different students learn in a different manner. So unless their learning process is uniform, then the data that you'd be gathering about the students and their scores is polluted.
Yeah.
And you cannot build a reference model on top of that. So different students learn differently, and there are techniques in which the students could learn and so they can have a certain way so they can increase their aptitude in scoring. And therefore that, then you can take it to the next level and see what type of content would actually help them learn better.
This is called artificial intelligence for a reason. It's artificial, it's trying to simulate your own intelligence. So if you don't have an answer, the machine won't have an answer. And what you should be doing primarily is, as Elie has suggested, you have data upon which you, as a human being, have been able to judge that this track is really beneficial or not. Well, going back to the issue of yes, each student has a different sort of reception to the material. I think, but also there are certain, but this was not your question. Your question was this probably content or is this methodology in teaching? Assuming you cannot really have those two components at the same time. So fixing student reception, like fix it is very good. You're not looking at that because then it becomes a very impossible problem to tackle. And maybe what you need to be doing is observing yourself on a cohort of historical data and see what have these books or contents or methodologies produced. And then I'm going to teach whatever algorithm to do it, but you asked about a model. So there are the long short-term memory neural networks which work on sequence classification. So give them a sequence. So this student started off with A in, say, that math course, and B in that chemistry course, and C in that physics course, and has come into college with that sort of baccalaureate exam. And then what do? Can I predict a sequence to that result using the input that I'm producing it to? So
hope you find your answer. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks.
Any questions?
I have a question about an IP. I need to use an IP in my application. Should I directly go and use already existing platforms? Should I use them directly? Or might I face scenarios where I need to create my own platform in order to answer a specific case that I might face?
So,
and is it worth the time to actually try to build this?
Yeah. Okay. So, anyone has...
To repeat the question, because yes. I'm sure, did you hear the question?
No.
So he was asking about NLP. He wants to use NLP in his project, and he was asking if it's a good idea to use an off-the-shelf NLP library, or should he build his own tools or libraries for NLP?
No, don't build. This is the most common problem. I mean, what you will be doing is that you will use machine learning to get value. You don't want to be doing, don't want to reinvent the wheel.
Yes.
You see? So, and I like Python because Python has a great community. So what you can do is that there are lots of great machine learning libraries and NLP. For example, there's NLTK. I don't know if you heard of it. NLTK. In Python, there are really good libraries for NLP. NLTK, Spacey, Jensen, use it along TensorFlow also for deep learning. So go do research and you'll see that there are lots of, Spacey for example is for production, it can handle massive amounts of data. So in my opinion, it's gonna be a waste of time to do everything from scratch. And even if you do it, it's not gonna be as good as the software engineers, big teams with open source. So whenever there's something that's a bug, you can see the source code, flag it, and they'll tell you, okay, we'll fix it, so.
And I also want to add to these libraries, we have OpenNLP and Stanford NLP, which they also provide open source libraries.
Yeah, they are used in Jensen, I think. Jensen,
yeah,
I mean, yes, it's on top of it.
Okay, I'm sorry.
No, it's okay, it's maybe for Java applications.
Yeah.
So mainly in Python, as you said, there are multiple libraries.
For Python, I think NLTK, Jensen, Spacey, these are good. And coupled with deep learning frameworks like Keras, TensorFlow, or PyTorch, this is a good trio.
Thank you.
Yes, Ella.
So, like we all know in Python, like if you use Keras, TensorFlow, or whatever, to build the model, just maybe two lines of code, and all we do maybe tune parameters or. So I'm still new to machine learning. I don't understand what is the main challenge of a data scientist. Is it in cleaning data? Is it in?
No, it's everything. I'll tell you what. Okay, it's not that you're building the model from scratch, which is another thing. I encourage you to build models from scratch, but not to use them. It's just to understand more what's happening under the hood. But don't do it for the sake of production. So the problem is, How to frame the problem, how to pick a metric that's relevant for the business or for whatever economics or anything, how to really create features that are meaningful, and how to, machine learning specifically is a search problem. So the hyperparameter space is huge, you see? So it's not about like compiling a small model and say fit. No, that's not it. You should know cleverly how to search in the hyperparameter space to pick really the best hyperparameters that will give you an optimal model. And at the end, as I said, the important thing is to not think about, I have a problem, deep learning is going to solve it. It's about picking models that work. The simplest possible is the most convenient. So if it's a logistic regression, try first with a logistic regression. If it doesn't work, try with something more complex. Because neural networks are not easily interpretable. So you will have a hard time interpreting which feature means what, because you know, you're stacking layers, everything gets lost. It's learning a feature representation. So in my opinion, focus, as I told you, it's really hard because it's really a practical problem and a search problem. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Suppose you have a certain personal project you're doing and you plan to use some sort of artificial intelligence in it. It is hard to predict how much effort you have to put in that project. So how do you determine whether it is worth it to actually start the project or not, since you don't have a way to tell how much effort it will take you?
So as a beginning, I think you should have a benchmark of what is your problem, and does anyone solve it or is thinking about it.
Or so there's actually examples where somebody actually faced it or talked about in the Quora or Reddit.
Do the research. Try researching.
Someone already faced the problem you're facing and just find some solution. If you don't, suggest it. Someone might help you.
So they have
and try to explore the data first. Always start by data exploration. This is the most important part. Because when you explore the data, you see if there's some dependencies that you can model. Otherwise, you can't find out. So it may be that no one worked on the problem before, or it's a very specific problem. So I suggest every time you want to start a project, just first start by really, cleaning the data and everything, but then statistical summaries, see if there's something relevant that you can model. Visualization, exploratory data analysis is very important.
And then there's a part in Stack Overflow, there's a term for Stack Exchange for artificial intelligence.
Yes, Quora also is very good. Quora.com. There are lots of helpful people. They're going to come and answer you. Oh, sometimes the experts, like you heard of Jan LeCun, for example, or Andrew Nick, they're going to come and sometimes answer your questions.
Yes.
So as Dr. Elie said, and after my experience, so if we don't know what we have in our data, we can solve. So as Dr. Elie said, please, before, just learn your data. Learn what you have before beginning any project.
Because you're making an assumption. When you're tackling a project, you're always making the assumption that, these features are able to learn a mapping to the labels. But that's not necessarily true. Machine learning doesn't work always. So it's basically, machine learning is basically pattern recognition. So let me just make this more clearly. When you say, this is a photo, this is a truck, you take the features and the label, the learning algorithm is not learning what the truck is. It's just taking some features, learning a pattern. This is called local generalization. Now, I like to cite this by the author of Keras, François Chollet. He has a blog, he spoke about this. So local generalization is not the same as extreme generalization. For example, we human beings have the ability to do extreme generalization. So when I see a picture of a person, I understand the essence of the person, not only the label. So you shouldn't rely a lot on machine learning. Machine learning makes strong assumptions. If you get the model, it's just simply pattern recognition. That's it. So sometimes it doesn't work. So as I said, first start by exploring the data, see if there are dependencies. Then try to model by establishing, as Nadine said, a benchmark. If you outperform the benchmark, then it's going to be promising. And then you can continue your...
So it's kind of like you're learning the data before the computer actually learns it.
Not learning, you're exploring. It's called exploratory data analysis. So you explore if really there's something going on. If you see, for example, that... For example, if you measure a feature and you have only one category, categorical feature, let's say you want to check the color of something that you are measuring, it turned out that it's all red. This is not an informative feature. You can drop it. You get my point? So you should see if the features that you are gathering, they have variance. Once they have variance and you see how the output depends on the features, then you can really see some correlations that are going on. Okay?
Thank you. Any questions?
If you have a chatbot that uses certain content to extract some hints, these hints might be useful for students to solve their exercises. What's the best way do it in artificial intelligence?
I haven't built a lot of chatbots to know. Maybe someone who has worked with NLP can help.
He's trying to use a natural language, a chatbot.
NLP third-party server, like API.ai or web.ai. You train it, you give it the information, it extracts it, it returns a JSON file, you just port it for the ones.
Exactly.
Let's say you're using a Facebook bot, you can actually program to put small buttons that do specific actions. If let's say you want to extend it, you can just let them write something and explore every single keyword you take from them.
So this, if you are using Facebook chatbot?
Yeah, even if it's on Slack, you can do it. It's specific channels.
Okay.
I didn't use NLP yet.
Oh, okay.
But okay. I hope you heard your answer.
Any questions before closing this session? No?
We continue and we'll be at the...
So, yes. So I would like to thank you, everyone who asked, who was shy to ask. So please, in this peer-to-peer networking, share the knowledge what you have. If you have any question, ask us, ask Dr. Elie or anyone. So, and have some donuts there. So thank you.
Thank you guys for coming.
And yes.
Hope to see you again.
Hope to see you again. Thank you guys.
Thank you.